गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू. टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट क्लास 7th एसएसटी पार्ट हिस्ट्री चैप्टर नंबर 3 द दिल्ली सल्तनत पार्ट 2. सो इन द प्रीवियस वीडियो आई हैड एक्सप्लेन द टू ऑफ द डायनेस्टीज दैट रूल्ड द दिल्ली सल्तनत. वन वाज मामलुक डायनेस्टी और स्लेव डायनेस्टी एंड अनदर वाज द खलजी डायनेस्टी. So in this video, I will explain about the rest of the dynasties which were ruled in the Delhi Sultanate. Now, beginning with the Tughlaq dynasty. So in the last video, I had also explained that the last Khalji ruler was Khushro Khan and he was killed by Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq. So basically, this led to the emergence of the new dynasty that came on the throne, that was the Tughlaq. Now starting with the Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, so his rule was approximately 1322-1325. Though he was able statesman and administrator, and he founded that the new dynasty, that is the Tughlaq dynasty. He believes the support of the people to run the government. So his belief is good that the people can help them to run his country or run his sultanate. So for that purpose, to make the people happy, he carried out many works, public works, basically like built wells and roads and many construction work he has done, because he wanted the subjects or the people of his empire to support him. Basically, he also constructed the Tughlaqabad fort on his on the behalf of his dynasty in Delhi, and he was succeeded by his son Jauna Khan. So basically, his period was very short, and he was succeeded by a good and educated educated ruler. We'll see about him, that the Jauna Khan. So Jauna Khan was also known as Muhammad bin Tughlaq. His reign was approximately 1325-1351. The Ibn Battuta, again, he was a foreign traveler. He came to India and he wrote about him. The Sultan was men much ahead of his time, who had great ideas and grandiose plans, which failed because the common people could not relate with them. Basically, Muhammad bin Tughlaq, he was far thinker. He wanted to apply different schemes for the welfare of his people, but somehow he failed, just because of that common people, the subjects of his empire, was not able to understand what is the main focus of Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Let us see some of his reforms that he took under his reign. First was the transfer of capital. So this was done by him because the area that is covered under, that was under the Tughlaq dynasty, was almost the whole part of the India, almost whole part of the India. So for that, he wanted a particular place that help him to rule the whole India. For this purpose, he shifted his capital from, he wanted to shift his capital from Delhi to Devagiri. And Devagiri is in the Deccan area, near the Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra. So basically, he wanted to shift his capital from Delhi to Devagiri, because Devagiri is in the mid part of the Indian subcontinent, and that is help him to rule the whole Indian subcontinent. He also renamed that Devagiri into the Daulatabad. But he But the Sultan, when he started moving from the Delhi to the Daulatabad, the long journey is made him and his subject very aggressive, because he ordered not only the transfer of his court and official, but entire population of the Delhi Sultanate, those who are living in the Delhi and peripheral areas. So extensive arrangements were made during that long journey, and the distance that is covered in for that Devagiri, it was 1500 kilometers. Temporary shelters were set up along the way, and free food and drinks were supplied. So because of this, enormous treasury is been spent for that particular reform, means the shifting of the capital. But his minister and his courtiers and soldiers, they are not keen to stay in the new location, and for that he had to take his order back, and the shifting of the transferring of his capital, is that procedure get stopped. So they came back to the Delhi again. So this initiative was good, that he will take care of the whole Indian part from a center part of the Indian subcontinent. But this initiative get failed just because of the common people do not understand, his subjects, his courtiers do not understand. Now another was the introduction of token money. So this is the most popular of his reforms, that the introduction of token money. He introduced the copper coin and bronze coin instead of the silver and gold coin. So the Sultan made these token coins into a legal tender that keep the value at par with the gold and silver coin. So he when the silver coin and brass coin was get introduced, so he asked that instead of gold and silver coin, you can use the copper and bronze coin for your daily works. So because of it, the market was flooded with the fake coins during that reason. So in this situation, Sultan had to withdraw the all copper coins, which is caused the loss to the huge royal treasury. So what he does, the coins and the copper coins and the bronze coins, what he introduced, he asked the people, the subjects of his territory, to just exchange, means the coins what he issued, that is to be submitted to the treasury, and in place of those coins they will get the silver and gold coins. So for that, his treasury started becoming empty. So this was the also fail of the this token currency that he had started. Another was reform was taxation of taxation reforms in Ganga Yamuna Doab. This was another the failure of his reforms. Like he started taking taxes in the Ganga Yamuna Doab up to the 50%, and he had started this at the time when the Ganga Yamuna Doab region is facing the famine condition. So this made when the production is not there, so the farmers were not able to pay the taxes, and this led to the fail of this reform also. So he has all of the reforms that it has been took by the Muhammad bin Tughlaq, it is all get failed. If we talk about the personally of the Muhammad bin Tughlaq, he was very learned person. He is well versed in Sanskrit, Arabic and Persian, many languages. He had also good command on religion, philosophy, science, literature. All if we count, like, he is very good, and learned person. Muhammad bin Tughlaq was died in 1351 and succeeded by his cousin Firoz Shah or the Firoz Shah Tughlaq. Let's see the Firoz Shah Tughlaq. So Firoz Shah Tughlaq, his reign was approximately 1351 to 1388. So Firoz Shah Tughlaq is also very generous person. He also knows that the support of the common people will help him to rule. So he took a number of major reforms for the administration purpose, and he also supported the noblemen and the ulemas. So he for the support of ulemas, he ruled his country with the Islamic law, and for the support of the nobles, he started iktadari system or the land distribution system again. So for this purpose, he got the support of noblemen as well as ulemas. Now he took many welfare measures, like banning the practice of inhuman punishment, establishment of hospitals for the poor, tanks, well, rest houses, canal for the irrigation purposes. Lot of major reforms done by the Firoz Shah Tughlaq during his reign. Also established new towns by his own name, like Firozabad, Firozpur, Jaunpur and Hisar Firoza. So these are the four of the towns that established by him. He set up two different departments for his ruling purpose, like Diwan-e-Khairat and Diwan-e-Bandagan. So Diwan-e-Khairat is for the poor people and the needy people, and Diwan-e-Bandagan is for the department of the slave. Basically, he wanted to do many more things for the people as well as the slaves also in his reign. So after his death, a series of rebellions break out, which is led to the end of the Tughlaq dynasty. So after the Firoz Shah Tughlaq, none of the successors were good and were not capable to strengthen the empire, and due to that, the Tughlaq dynasty become end. Now let's start we'll read about one of the invasion during the Tughlaq dynasty and the next dynasty. Here the incapable rulers of the Tughlaq dynasty give the chance to the Mongol ruler, that is Tamur, to attack on India. So the Tamur was the ruler of Samarkand, and he was the founder of Tamurid dynasty basically. So he got to know that the Indian rulers were so weak and were not able to hold the empire very well. So with his army, he plundered the Delhi and carried away enormous booty and many Indian artisans with him. So with these wealth, whatever he captured from the India, with all those money, he beautified his capital Samarkand, like building palaces, mosques and grand buildings. So he had done lot of things with the money that he captured or he looted from the Indian subcontinent. While returning back to his country, the Tamur appointed one of his representative administrator in India. His name was Khizr Khan, and the beginning of the new dynasty we'll read in the next slide. Now the time is for the new dynasty, that is the Sayyid dynasty, from 1414 to 1451. So this dynasty is started or established by the Khizr Khan. He was the representative of the Tamur. So Khizr Khan was the governor during the Firoz Shah Tughlaq. When the Firoz Shah Tughlaq rules were there, he was the governor during that time. But he helped Taimur on his invasion when he invaded the India, basically Delhi Sultanate. So in praise of that, the Khizr Khan got the three areas, the governorship of the three areas, that is Multan, Lahore and Dipalpur. So these are the places or the areas that is comes under the Khizr Khan. And he was ruled up to 1421, but under the chaos and the disorder. So this, his rule was very short and very much uncertain, and because of it, the Khizr Khan was not capable to rule his whole territory, and due to that, the next successor has came, that his name was Mubarak Shah Sayyid. So Mubarak Shah Sayyid is also there for the very short reason, like he get the throne because of the he done a successful expedition against the Mewatis, Katihars and the Gangatic Doab region. So basically he get the chance to suppress the rebellions during the Khizr Khan Sayyid, and because of it, the Subedar, the nobles, were so happy with him and make him king or sultan of the Delhi Sultanate. So after getting the throne, many Subedars were started revolting against him, and his reason was only full of rebellions, and he spent his all of the time for rebelling, suppressing the rebels, those who were during his reason. But after some time, he was killed by his own nobles of his own court. So this was very short reason, and he was not that much capable to strengthen his empire and keep the nobles check on them. Now, after Mubarak Shah, the new sultan has came, that was Muhammad Shah Sayyid. His reason was also short, like he when he was on the throne, Muhammad Shah Sayyid was on the throne, the nobles made him the puppet, and he rules according to the nobles, and his the area which he had ruled, it was very limited, means that he only ruled the Delhi and the peripheral areas. Rest of the part was ruled by the nobles of the Mubarak Shah Sayyid. Ruler of Malwa invaded Delhi, but during that time, the Muhammad Shah Sayyid was saved by the Bahlol Lodi, and Bahlol Lodi was the Subedar of Lahore in the region of Muhammad Shah Sayyid. So this gave the chance to Bahlol Lodi to came into power. But before that, one more ruler was there. His name was Alauddin Alam Shah, after the Muhammad Shah Sayyid. So Alauddin Shah was last Sayyid king, and he himself retired from the throne independently, and this gave the chance to Bahlol Lodi to get the throne. So this, his reason was very short, and he himself, because he saw several rebellions and nobles wanted to conquer his throne, but he himself retired, he himself leave the throne, and this provide the chance to the Bahlol Lodi to came into the power. Now, when Bahlol Lodi came into power, this arises a new dynasty, that is the Lodi dynasty, and the last dynasty of the sultans in the Delhi regions. So the Lodi dynasty rule was approximately 1451 to 1526. So Bahlol Lodi was there. He was there for longer period. He was an Afghan sardar, and he established himself in the Punjab when he got the chance to rule after the invasion of Timur. So when he came into power, he removes all the rebellious governors from his court and made the Afghan nobles, those who are loyal to the Bahlol Lodi, to the part of the court. He took control many areas like Jaunpur Rewal, Itawa, Mewar, Sambal, Gwalior. There are so many places that he conquered, is approximately from Punjab to the Bihar areas. That all regions comes under the Bahlol Lodi. Bahlol Lodi was very patron of art and architecture, and he was also very learned person. Now, the Bahlol Lodi was there succeed by his own son. His name was Sikandar Lodi. So Sikandar Lodi was the son of the Bahlol Lodi. He founded a new city. It was named as Agra, and he made the Agra his capital of his sultanate from the Delhi. And he also, Sikandar Lodi also conquered Bihar, Jaunpur, and made the friendly alliances with the ruler of Bengal. So basically, he knew that if he made the friendly alliances to the other territories of India, he will be able to rule. He was very interested in agriculture development, because he knew that if agriculture will be good, he will get the maximum amount of tax and his treasury will full. So for this purpose, he done a lot of welfare scheme to the common people. Like likewise Alauddin Khilji has done the lowering of prices of essential commodities, like providing the loans to the farmers. Lot of activities it was started by the Sikandar Lodi. Now he was succeeded by his own son. His name was the Ibrahim Lodi, and he was the last ruler, last sultan of the Delhi Sultanate. He asserted the absolute power of the sultan and removed the power of the nobles. So he removed all the powers of nobles during his regents, because he knows that the nobles will not lead to the ruler to rule properly. So for that purpose, he removed all of his nobilities or noble groups from his region. So the governor of the Daulat Khan invited the Babur to overthrow the Ibrahim Lodi. So what is the reason behind the Daulat Khan was helping the Babur? The reason was that the governorship of Ibrahim Lodi do not want any nobles to be ruled. So for that purpose, he removed all nobles and his power. He lessened the power of the governors basically. So because of it, Daulat Khan get angry, and he asked the Babur. So who was Babur? He was Mongol ruler. And we'll read more about the Babur in the next chapter. So Babur is there. He came and the Battle of Panipat. The first Battle of Panipat fought between the Ibrahim Lodi and the Babur. So this battle is led to the entrance of the Mongol Empire. So from 1526, the entrance of Mongol ruler and the end of the Sultan rulers is the marked as a battle of the Battle of Panipat is marked as a end of Sultanate period and the starting of the Mongol ruler. So In Battle of Panipat 1526, Ibrahim Lodi was defeated and also killed by the Babur. So probably it has been said that he is the only Sultan was killed in the battle. So after the death of the Ibrahim Lodi, the new dynasty has emerged. That was the Mongol dynasty or the Mughal Empire. So that was laid, the foundation, it was started by the Babur. We'll read about him in the next chapter. Let's see some of the management during the Sultanate period. Like the administration, whatever the administration in the Sultanate, it was done by the Sultan. So basically, Sultan is the head of the whole empire and he is responsible for the protection of the external attacks. He is also responsible for the maintenance of law and order in his empire. He is the commander in chief of the army, and also he is worked as a chief justice of the Sultanate. So these are the powers of Sultan. Whosoever will be Sultan, the power may be asserted with him. But I had explained also that many nobles were there. They have the most of the power instead of the Sultanate period. But almost all the sultans, whosoever is ruled during the Sultanate period, they all have all these powers. Now, after the Sultan, one more group is there, that is the nobles and officials, that were also considered as important links for the Sultanate. Now, let us see some of the nobles that was there to help the king. Like a wazir and his deputies. So wazir is the prime minister of the Sultanate, and his other helpers are there to look after the matter of income, expenditure, whatever the income is there, how they spend. Also, the collection of revenue, control of revenue, etc. So, these are the works that comes under the wazir and his deputies. Next one is Ariz-e-Mamlik. So, this is a department that led for the recruitment of the soldiers, their training and the equipment. So, they are the responsible for the soldiers or the army basically of the Sultanate period. Wakil-e-Dar, he is there for the look after the household of the Sultan, means the family of the Sultan, whatever the needs are there, the palace, the guards, and the personal assistants. So all of these are look after by the Wakil-e-Dar in the Sultanate period. Amir-e-Hajib, his responsibility is to conduct the ceremonies at the court. So whatever the ceremonies will be there in the court, that is responsible of the Amir-e-Hajib to take control over it. Chief Qazi. So Chief Qazi was there too. He was known as the head of the justice department, though the king was there. But for the rest of the thing, it is the responsibility of Chief Qazi to look after all kind of justice in the Sultanate period. Now, the nobles are there. They are the civilian and military positions in the Sultanate. They also assist the Sultan and discharge his responsibility and help him to rule the empire. So there is a rank for the these nobles, like Khan is the superior one. After that, Maliks and Amir. So these are the basically the nobles according to the post. So the highest post occupied is by the Khan, then Maliks and the Amirs. So the nobles, whosoever is there, they got the salaries from the revenue. Whatever the revenue assigned to them, they get the salaries from them. And when it's time for the Ikta system, the land resources of Sultanate, it was divided among the nobles, and in behalf of that, they will get the cash for their services. और द इक्तादास दोज आर लिविंग इन देयर इन द टेरिटरीज दोज आर हैविंग द टेरिटरीज दे कलेक्ट द टैक्सेस फ्रॉम द फार्मर एंड दैट टैक्सेस वर यूज्ड टू मेंटेन द आर्मी फॉर द प्रोटेक्शन ऑफ द सुल्तान्स एंड द सल्तनेट. ओके हेयर इज one more important point that you have to understand, the slaves. So slave is you know very well, the person who is bounded to work according to his master. So slaves are there, and they were also present in the royal household. Sometimes they serve as a personal assistant, sometimes they were the part of the administrative officials and many others. So there were so many peoples like slaves are there, they works as a various post, like whether they are the administrating post, whether they are the assistants. So the slaves are very helpful during that period. One of the Diwane Bandagan, I had explained, that is only meant for the slaves of the Delhi Sultanate. Now let us see the armies during the Sultanate period. So armies are there to help the Sultan to stay in power, that you know very well, and also to expand his empire and defend his empire. So basically army is there. Present day also we need army to protect our territories also, if any invasion is there, to defend our country. So for that purpose, in the previous time also, the army was meant to help the empire for the protection as well as the stay in power. So their army was comprised of infantry, means foot soldiers, cavalry, means horse soldiers, archers and the elephants. So these are the armies which are helping, which were helping the Sultans to rule his empire very well. The horses of the fine quality, they get the great attention, and they were imported from the Arabia. So horses were there, and for the good quality of horses, Alauddin Khilji started a new tradition. It was known as Daag. So Daag was the tradition that was started by Alauddin Khilji to brand the horses which are the good qualities. Means that the good qualities of horses were branded by a Daag, a stamp mark on their body, to identify that they are of the good quality. Means they can check whether the horse is of the good quality, means the fast runner or the good quality, or whatever the quality is needed for the good horse, that they are branded, or the Daag is, it has been used for them. And another it was started by Alauddin Khilji was the Chehra. It is the full description of the soldiers. Full description means how they looks, what is their height, likewise. So the whole details of the soldiers was kept, that is known as the Chehra. Both are started by the Alauddin Khilji. During the reign of the Alauddin Khilji, the soldiers were paid in cash, means they were get salaried. So I explained in the last topic also, that the Alauddin Khilji, he controlled his market policy, that I had explained, and also he fixed the prices of all commodity, and because of it he lowered the all prices of commodity, and because of this he has to pay a very less salary to his soldiers, that they can survive, they can easily purchase all the commodities which are required for the daily survival. So this was done by the Alauddin Khilji. Now let us see the division of Sultanate. So basically the division of Sultanate is the head, the Delhi Sultanate, the whole Delhi Sultanate is divided into province. It is also known as Suba, and which is further divided into the Sikh, Okay, the head of the Subas were the Muktis, and the head of the Sikh was the Sikhdar. The Sikh was divided into Parganas. So Pargana is the cluster of villages. It is number of several villages, and Pargana is headed by the Amil. Now, there is a Patwari. He is there to maintain the record of the land and also crops and the taxes that is to be paid by the villagers or the farmers of that particular area. So Patwari is there to maintenance of the record and the record of the land and crops and the other things. Now in the villages areas, there is two important officials that is belongs to the sultanate, that is the Khuds and the Muqaddam. So these people are there to help the ruler to look after the villages areas, and they are the important officials in every villages of the Delhi Sultanate. Now let us see the economy during the period of the Sultanate period. So economy, whatever the taxes is there, that was known as the kharaz or land tax, house tax. There are so many taxes during that period, or whatever the taxes is to be collect, it is to maintain the army, construct the building, pay the officials. So these taxes are used to do all these things, or for the economic purpose. I had explained also the Alauddin Khilji, he made the unique market reform policy, or like fixing of the commodities and lowering the salaries. There are so many things. He himself took the keen interest in the market and the prices of it. So the Alauddin Khilji's market policy was very helpful for the maintaining of the economy of the Sultanate period. Okay, one more thing. Muhammad bin Tughlaq's taxes reform that he done in the Doab area, though his reform was not successful because of the famine, but in the rest of the time, the taxes which were uplifted up to the 50% of the produce, it was very helpful for the rulers to rule, and they get the much more taxes from the Ganga Yamuna Doab areas, because that area was very fertile and the production of that area was very more. Now, society of the Sultanate period. So society, it's like that. The administrative post was reserved for the nobles, and they are helping the noble families, the ruler families. Also, the caste system during that was permeated all the religion, and slaves were bought and sold. Means whatever the slaves, they can purchase from any country, they can sold. They can sell the slave to any country, and also sometimes these slaves, whosoever is bought from any part of the country or any part of the world, they get the highest post in administration, sometimes in army. But during that period, the peasant lived in poverty, because they have not get the any kind of chance to be the part of the nobles or the Sultanate period. So they Sultan basically, and also they lived in a misery condition, because they had to pay a lot of taxes, or this was the condition during the Sultanate period. So basically, these are the things that you have to read in this chapter. Though I had explained the all of the five of the dynasty which is been ruled in the Delhi area and were known as the Delhi Sultans. And in the next video, we'll read about the next starting of the Mongol ruler or the Mughal ruler in the next video. So here, I would like to tell you that I wanted to encourage you people for the reading of the books. You further read the books. If you have any confusion, you can ask me. The homework is that you have to write the all of the rulers, the founder of the all of the dynasty during the Delhi Sultanate period and write in your copy. Thank you, students.